So we're talking about the spread of Calvinism in France. In the year 1558, the Calvinists, or Huguenots as they were called in French, or the perhaps the anglicized pronunciation, but they were called, now we call them the Huguenots. They began to hold regular evening meetings in Paris. Yes. It's a bit mysterious, the exact origin of it, but it seems to possibly be derived from a German word, actually. But that's the etymology of that, something you can investigate on your own if you're particularly interested in it. It just means French Calvinists. That's all it means. I remember growing up near there was a road not far from where I lived that had that name. It was Huguenot Road, I remember. Spelled a little bit differently from that, but that's how everybody pronounced it. That was my first exposure to the word. It was just, as far as I knew, it was just the name of a road. Come to find out later on, it's also the name of French Protestants, French Calvinists. But whatever the case concerning the name, they started meeting in Paris in 1558. So, we talked yesterday about how heresies, despite how detrimental they are to civil authority, always seem to spring up in the shadow of civil authority. Of course, anybody who was here at least last year remembers what happens to heretics who do not have the support of civil authority. Like John Huss, they end up getting burned at the stake, in some sense. So on the 14th of June, the following year, 1559, the French Parliament, assembled to take measures against the invasion of Calvinism. So it was not welcome. So the president and also other ministers of the French Parliament were in favor of the rigorous application of the laws made by Philip Augustus against innovators. Anybody remember anything about King Philip Augustus of France? We didn't study him this year, but anybody know anything about him? Anything notable? Yeah, he was one of the monarchs who went on the Third Crusade originally. Then he ended up clashing with, anybody know with whom he clashed? If you don't even know, he went on the Crusade, probably not. He ended up clashing with King Richard I of England, Richard the Lionhearted as he's known, causing Philip to break away from the Crusade. Go back to France. But that's from earlier centuries. Right now, his influence still lives on, though, in these laws that he passed against innovators that the French Parliament is now in favor of enforcing. So these French ministers are in favor of applying the full rigor of applicable laws against Calvinists, which is not a bad idea, obviously. But on the other hand, several counselors undertook to defend the heretics and gave way to recriminations and abuse against the court of Rome. So there were some who were caught in the spell of the Protestants, of the Calvinists, the heretics, who want to overthrow not only, of course, the church in France, but as we'll see, also even the civil order, which really should not be surprising at this point. But that's what they want to do, and certain French ministers have been caught up in that. So the most violent of these declaimers was an apostate priest named Anne Dubourg. So he's one of them. It's good to know his name. You find different spellings of it. Anyway, this was an apostate priest who embraced the cause of Protestantism in France. So out of one day, he was leaving the meeting hall of the French Parliament, he was taken prisoner, he was arrested. The Bishop of Paris declared him a heretic, deposed him from the priesthood, and gave him over to the secular arm. So that's what happens when church and state, when they're joined as they're supposed to be, and the mechanisms are working correctly. This is what happens to heretics. They're arrested and handed over to the secular power for punishment. Arrested, you know, tried by ecclesiastical court for their heresy, but then handed over to the civil power for the suitable punishment. Though he appealed, Dubourg appealed to the Archbishop of Sens, who was the Metropolitan of Paris. The death of King Henry II of France, which occurred in the interval, did not interrupt the trial. It was continued by order of his successor, Francis II, who was guided by his uncles, the princes of Lorraine, who were his regents. And then that's what happens when, typically when a king dies, his son is not old enough to yet assume the throne, or his heir, whoever his heir is not old enough to assume the throne. There would be a regent, someone to reign for the king until he comes to an age, because you don't want to have a five-year-old ruling a kingdom. It has to wait until he's a normal age for to start ruling. Whatever that age was, whatever majority was considered in those times, it had to wait until he could reach that age before he would actually take the reins of power. And sometimes, and we've seen even examples of it this year in some of these Italian wars, how regents would not want to themselves to give up the reins of power to someone they who a child really, and for whom they had been administering whatever kingdom it was, whatever power, they would not want to give it up, and then wars would ensue from that. But in this case, the regents are acting correctly, of course, in ordering that the trial of a heretic be continued. So Dubourg saw the president of the French Parliament, so the one who oversaw everything, among his judges. He said to him in a threatening tone, "You shall not long be my judge." So he seemed to have some knowledge that there was some kind of a revolution in the works. Of course, this is still hundreds of years before the French Revolution, but this is an attempt. We'll see. It'll be an attempt of Protestants to take over the Kingdom of France, even in the 16th century, or starting then. So, of course, Protestants took care to ensure that this prophecy, so-called prophecy, would be fulfilled. The president, so this the president of the French Parliament, Minard, was his name, was assassinated the same evening as he was entering his abode. So he was going home. He was killed by Protestants who wanted to make sure that this apostate priest would have his revenge. So it was discovered later on that the same fate was prepared for other French ministers too, but for whatever reason it didn't work. They were not in the right place at the right time for the plots to go through, so they were paracetamol, they were spared. But they were very definitely, these Protestants, see, they're already starting to try their overthrow, to overthrow the Catholic order everywhere they can. Starting with ministers who try the first heretics to come to light. But 3 days later, notwithstanding all of that, the apostate priest Dubourg was condemned, hanged, and burned. So he was put to death. So clearly the mechanisms are still working in France at this point. The Calvinists, secretly encouraged by Elizabeth of England, turned their thoughts to the organization of an open revolt. So no longer just assassinations, they're going to rise up in force, in arms, just like the peasants' revolt in Germany that we saw. They're going to, but again, not only peasants, they're also going to get higher people among their ranks to work for them. The wars of religion, as they have been styled, were now, for half a century, to cover France with terror, bloodshed, and ruins. So we'll see more about that later on. So now we're on to that. That's the... So now we're on to... That was the end of the reign of Pope Paul IV. Now we're on to the reign of Pope Pius IV. Numbers become confusing. So yes, we're finishing the reign of Pope Paul IV. Now on to Pius IV. So his dates are... December 26th, so day after Christmas. December 26th of 1559 through December 9th. So he's another Medici to assume the papal throne. So Cardinal Giovanangelo de Medici was taking possession of the chair of St. Peter under the title of Pius IV. The Lutheran and Calvinist heresies were continuing to commit fearful ravages in Europe. England, under the rule of the daughter of Henry VIII and Anne Boleyn, so Elizabeth, now Elizabeth I, was wading through torrents of blood in the way of schism. In Scotland, the fierce zealot, Knox, John Knox, was setting up the most intolerant Calvinism, so really a very militant Calvinism, throwing both church and state into utter disorder. This sect was also making progress in the Netherlands under favor of the popular hatred of Spanish rule. So again, at this time, the Netherlands, which is a larger area than the country of the Netherlands is now, that area was all under Habsburg control at the time. And is there's resentment against the Spanish rule, but again, also Protestantism is spreading. And also, Elizabeth is going to, we'll see it later, but she's going to, in the future, from where we are now, going to support that revolt. Again, not openly going to declare war on Spain, that would not have been a good idea, but she's going to wage war against Spain effectively through these proxies, these rebels in the Netherlands. Yeah, it just goes to show that nothing really ever changes. To this day, I mean, it happens that there are what are called proxy wars. In other words, a war in which you definitely have two major powers that are in opposition to each other, but they don't want to go to war openly. So they'll fight each other either through their allies, through weaker allies that each side supports, or one will openly fight the ally of one or the other, supported by the opposite party. So it's what you have here, basically a proxy war between France and England at this time, because there are certain advantages to a proxy war. For one thing, you don't have all of the inconveniences of a full-fledged state of war between two major powers. And in this case also, it's just that Elizabeth did a lot of things like that. She would support rebels like this. We saw she supported Calvinists in France. She would also give essentially license to pirates like Francis Drake. I assume everybody knows who Francis Drake was. Famous pirate who... went around marauding, hijacking Spanish ships and stealing all their wealth, and was also one of the first people to circumnavigate the globe. Anybody know who the first one was? Yes. Yeah, right. So just so you know, that's not only the name of a GPS brand. That is also the name of the person who first circumnavigated the globe. And according to what I've read, it was Francis, at some point Magellan marooned some sailors who had been rebels or something. He left them on some island somewhere. And then Francis Drake came by decades later and marooned some sailors at the same spot and found the skeletons of the people that Magellan had left behind. So, morbid, but they both had the same idea, marooning people at the same place. So, Philip II appreciated the political importance of opposing the advance of these doctrinal novelties. So he has figured out that, just from watching what's going on in Germany, if through no other means, he has figured out that it's not a good idea to let heresy flourish if you're a civil ruler. Philip II, at least, has figured that out. And I would see there are measures being taken against Protestantism in France as well. But Philip II, of course, very prominently, but currently the King of France, again, is a child, though at this point, Philip II, the ruler of Spain, has realized that he has to oppose heresy, not only for the good of souls in his kingdom, but also for just maintaining order on the streets, really. So at his request, Pope Paul IV had erected 3 new metropolitan sees in Utrecht, Mechelen, and Cambrai, besides several bishoprics. Now, so of course, Utrecht will come into prominence later on for bad reasons. The German Protestants, availing themselves of the liberty granted them by the Treaty of Passau, began the publication of a new ecclesiastical history known as the Centuriators of Magdeburg. So whenever you see reading, whenever you read about Martin Luther, and you see things about this citations from the Centuriators of Magdeburg, those are Protestant scholars. So if you ever come across those names and know who they are, the first volume is appearing in 1559. Yes. It's the Centuriators. There's of Magdeburg. So even if you read, say, the abridged version of Hartwig Grisar, you'll see a lot of mention of them. He uses them either to prove things, in other words, saying Protestants themselves admit these things, or to show, perhaps, that sometimes they say ridiculous things in defense of Martin Luther. But in any case, if you ever see any that work ever cited, you know where it comes from. So just as the Lutherans had absorbed the scattered remains of the Hussites in Germany, so the remaining Waldenses, other heretics from earlier centuries, dwelling in the mountains, naturally fell into the ranks of the Calvinists. So again, Protestants or heretics in general are consolidating themselves at this point. Their number amounted to about 3,000 or 4,000. They caused great troubles, as heretics we've seen typically do, and brought upon themselves some very severe treatment from royal forces. So again, this is in France. Yes. Everybody, all of these insurgents were about 4,000. At least that's what I think that's what the author is saying. It's a little bit unclear. I have to check that, actually, exactly the number is. That's true, that is a little ambiguous. So at this point, the court of Francis II, King Francis II of France, was divided among 3 factions, headed by the 3 principal families of France, the houses of Bourbon, Montmorency, and Lorraine. So all these people come into play. We'll see them a lot in the future. At the head of the Bourbon family was Antoine, King of Navarre and the Duke of Vendôme. He was of apparently a weak and vacillating disposition. And he hesitated between, he wasn't sure whether he wanted to be a Catholic, which was, of course, not only the Catholic, the faith, of course, required to hold in order to be a member of the Catholic Church, but also the faith of St. Louis IX and Charlemagne, really be called the religion of France, and the novelties of an apostate German monk. So you think it wouldn't be much of a choice for a Frenchman, but apparently he couldn't decide. For political motives, he couldn't decide what he wanted. But yielding at length to the influence of his wife, something is not uncommon, who had already been misled by the new errors, he gave his name to the cause of the Reformation. So yeah, he's weak and vacillating, so how firmly he held to it, I don't know. Arthur Darras says he never was really a firm adherent, perhaps. But in any case, he gave his name to it, so he's publicly a Protestant. The Prince of Condé, Louis de Bourbon, declared his sentiments openly and thus became the leader of the Lutherans and Calvinists in the kingdom. So now you have high-ranking noblemen declaring themselves in favor of Protestantism in France. So it's really spreading. So the House of Lorraine was divided into two branches. The Lorraines, we'd say in English, and the Guises, was represented by three princes. Charles III, Duke of Lorraine, and that does have an English pronunciation, whose descendants, at the time this book was written, were still on the thrones of Austria, Hungary, and Bohemia. Yeah, in the 19th century. Francis, the Duke of Lorraine, Francis of Lorraine, Duke of Guise, and the Cardinal of Lorraine, who was the very all-powerful, at this point anyway, minister of Francis II. They had pledged themselves at any price to maintain the Catholic faith in France. So clearly we have the preparations for a war here. High-ranking noblemen on both sides declaring themselves either in favor of Protestantism or willing to defend the faith. When you have that going on, you're going to have arms get involved, typically. But there was a third party which hoped to restore peace between the other two, and by this reconciliation, to spare the bloodshed which would inevitably ensue otherwise, which was that of Montmorency. So you have the Protestants, the Catholics, and then you have people in the middle who want to reconcile. They're probably themselves Catholics, but they don't want to see a war happen in any event. So Pius IV, sorry, that's what you have going on. That's the religious situation in France at the beginning of the reign of Pius IV. He was helped, Pius IV, in the government of the church by his nephew, St. Charles Borromeo, who was alive at this time, which would also mean that there was another saint alive at this time. Anybody know who that would be? Yes, but there's another one also I'm thinking about. Yeah. Yes. You paid attention when we read that book a couple of years ago. So, St. Charles Borromeo is alive, yes. St. Philip Neri is alive, and St. Pius V is also alive. Does anybody know the name of St. Pius V before he was elected pope? We'll find out later. Now, he was Cardinal Ghislieri, but we'll find out. We'll see. We'll read more about him later. In fact, he opposed the raising of St. Charles Borromeo to the cardinalate. He didn't know who he was. He just knew this was... his predecessor raising one of his nephews to a high position. He said, you shouldn't be doing that. He didn't know that it was a saint who was being raised to that position, but he opposed it. And in principle, that's true. I mean, it's really done out of nepotism, but in itself, perhaps only per accidens, but in itself, of course, a good choice. So now look at St. Charles Borromeo a bit. He was born in 1538 of the noble family of the Counts of Borromeo. He was remarkable for his fervent piety and wisdom beyond his years, so as many saints are in their early years. On entering the ecclesiastical career, he was presented with several rich benefices, but he respectfully represented to his father what remained of his revenues, after deducting the amount necessary for his education and the service of the church. He said that, so he gave them back to his father, saying that they belonged to the poor, and that any other use of them would be unlawful. So he didn't want to become overly attached to his riches. You know, he was born in a noble family. They had wealth. He didn't want to become attached to it. He gave most of it up. So he had just finished his studies in canon law at Milan when he received tidings of the election of his uncle, you know, Cardinal de' Medici. We just saw that it was another Medici who was elected in the person of Pius IV to the papal throne. And he received an order to repair at once to Rome. Again, to repair means to go to a place. Doesn't mean that he was required to get into a broken down carriage and fix it every 10 feet. He was required to go to Rome. So it's an older usage of the word, but that's what it means. To repair to a place means to go there. So he was immediately made a cardinal and Archbishop of Milan, though he was only 23 years old. And in spite of all of his earnest endeavors to avoid those dignities. So everybody in here who's 23 or older, think if you were St. Charles Borromeo, you would already be an archbishop. You would already be a cardinal archbishop. Although it was a pope, I believe it was Benedict XV, who was made a monsignor when he was still a seminarian. I think it was Benedict XV, and I believe that's the dignity he was raised to. But yeah, we'll see that future centuries. That's not the subject matter for this course. I'd have to check that though. Don't quote me on that at the moment. So, Pius IV. Hopefully it was on account of recognizing the virtues of his nephew, and not simply out of nepotism, but Dara says that he wished to honor the virtue of St. Charles, and to avail himself of his great zeal and talents in the government of the church. So Dara likes to whitewash things, so of course, hopefully that was the case, but of course, it's difficult to read motives. And certainly at this time, the presumption would simply have been a desire to advance one's family, a pope doing things like that. So that's what Dara says, even if its first appearances are to the contrary. So, of course, he did. Now we know St. Charles Borromeo, of course, he wasn't canonized at the time. We now know that he gave his unvarying attention to his duties as a cardinal and archbishop of the largest diocese in the world. And his first care was to enter, by the order of Pius IV, into negotiations for the reopening of the Council of Trent, which had been interrupted since the pontificate of Julius III. So the bull was published on the 29th of November, 1560, in which the Pope said, immediately upon being called to the government of the church, we were sensible that the only means of successfully opposing the spread of schism, heresy, and moral corruption was to resume the ecumenical council already convoked by Paul III, and by Julius III, his successor of happy memory, the Lord having at length vouchsafed to grant peace and unity among Christian kings and princes, it seemed to us that nothing now stands in the way of its celebration. So basically, he's saying there's need for this council to be resumed, and there are no political problems preventing it right now, so let's do it. That's an uneloquent way of saying what you just said there. So if you have trouble following the flowery language of it, there's a simplified version. Although a great many times, a lot of documents, responses sent by popes to various leaders could simply be summed up in the words, drop dead, later on, especially. But This one is, of course, a bull to continue a council. It's not a reprimand to any political leader. All right, stop there.